You are welcome for today's lesson. We are looking at the thrombocytes and also lymphatic system. Pay attention in order for you to have the solid understanding on this topic that we are discussing today. Straight away, let's talk about what is a thrombocytes. Thrombocytes is just one of the cellular composition of the blood as a tissue. We talked about the erythrocytes. We talk about leukocytes. Today it's now the time for us to talk about the thrombocytes as being one of the types of the cells that is going to be found in the tissue or the blood. So these are thrombocytes. They are in layman's language called platelets, and they are said to be the very small cells without a nucleus, just like it is with the red blood cells. The thrombocytes, they do not have the nucleus. And they are about 2 to 4 micrometer in diameter, to mean that they are very small compared to those other cells that makes up the blood. And these are platelets. They are actually derived from the cytoplasm of the megakaryocytes, which are found in the red bone marrow. And we're going to talk about the formation of the thrombocytes, which is going to help us to understand this more fully. So we're saying that these thrombocytes, actually they contain a variety of substance that are essential in the promotion of the blood clotting, more especially in an instance whereby there's an injury that has occurred. Now, in order for us to cease this bleeding, or in order to have the stoppage of the bleeding, that's what the thrombocytes are going to do, or that's its function to actually result in what is called hemostasis. Hemostasis in this case is just the stoppage of the bleeding, or the cessation of the bleeding, which is the primary function of the thrombocytes as the cells in the blood. So this is the diagram of the platelets, or the descriptions. So just like we have already mentioned, here you can see the visual aid that is showing the red blood cells and the platelets. And looking at them, they seem to appear the same. That's why we said they all do not have the nucleus, and the platelets are formed from the red bone marrows in the bone. And when the blood vessels ruptured, actually the platelets are the one that are essential in the stoppage of that bleeding by resulting in the process of hemostasis. Okay, so now the platelets, they control the bleeding just like we have said, but their production, it is stimulated by the protein called thrombopoietin, which actually results in the production of the platelets in an instance whereby there's an injury that has to be secured in order to stop the bleeding. And from the time when these platelets have been produced from the bones, they have only about 8 to 11 days of their lifespan. At the end, they get to be destroyed by the spleen, which is the organ essential of destruction of the abnormal cells and those are odd cells. As we are talking about the lymphatic system, pay attention to this point that we have said, because we are going to come across it as we are going further in our discussion for today. So this is what we have been talking about. We said that the protein, or rather the hormone that is essential in the production of the platelets, it is actually the thrombopoietin. So the thrombopoietin from the kidney, the liver, it is going to stimulate the production of these thrombocytes in the bones, and then the myeloid stem cells in the bones are going to be stimulated. When the myeloid stem cells are stimulated, it is going to result in the production of the megakaryoblasts. These megakaryoblasts are just the immature cells that are essential in the developing into the megakaryocyte. And are these megakaryocytes that are going to be produced and released in the blood vessels to result in the platelets, as it is demonstrating on this visual here. Now we talk about the process of hemostasis. Just like we have mentioned, the primary function of these platelets, or the thrombocytes, it is actually the hemostasis. Now, what is the process of this hemostasis? We need to understand that. The first thing you're saying that when the blood vessels gets damaged, actually the stoppage of bleeding is going to occur through the overlapping process, and this overlapping process, it is going to be enhanced by these platelets that I'm talking about here. So the first thing that is going to happen in an instance where if the injury has occurred, first thing that you're going to see there will be the vasoconstriction. And when you say the vasoconstriction, in this case, we're just talking about the narrowing of the blood vessels so as to reduce the amount of blood that will be flowing towards that site. And this is enhanced when the platelets actually they adhere to the walls of the blood vessels that have been damaged so as to reduce its lumen. And when they does that, they are going to release the serotonin. And this serotonin, it has the mechanism of constricting the blood vessels so as to reduce the blood flow through those vessels towards the site that have been injured. The mechanism, its function is only to lower or to reduce the amount of blood that is flowing towards the site so that the narrowing and the vasoconstriction, or rather at the end, the clotting of blood can be enhanced. So the chemicals that causes constriction, for instance, thromboxanes, are also released at the site of injury by the cells themselves. Remember, the serotonin is going to be produced at the thrombocytes, and this thromboxanes, it is going to be produced by the cells that have been damaged themselves, so as it to ensure that there's actually the reduction of the bleeding, or rather the stoppage of the bleeding. The second step that is going to happen after an injury has occurred from vasoconstriction, there will be the platelet plaque formation. So this platelet plaque formation, how is it going to be formed? We said that these thrombocytes are going to adhere to the walls of the vessels that have been damaged. When they adhere, they are going to release other substances, like for example, adenosine diphosphate, which is going to attract more cells of the platelets to arrive at the site of injury. And when this occurs, the platelets that are going to be brought, they are going also to aggregate together with those that have arrived at first and forming the sticky substance on the injured site. So this is said to be the positive feedback mechanism, in that the occurrence of an injury, it is going to increase the production of the platelets formation. And we are saying that it is going to result, they are saying that this is a positive feedback system by which many platelets rapidly arrive at the site of vascular damage and quickly form a temporary seal. So this temporary seal that is going to be formed due to the adhesion or adherence of these platelets is what now is going to be called as the platelet plaque. So here we can see the visual aid that is demonstrating the platelet plaque has this formed. We can see the first diagram here, it is showing the platelet's deposition and adhesion. So here, because there's an injury that has occurred in the blood vessels, if you can see the diagram below here, there will be aggregation of the platelets that are going to arrive at the site of the injury. From that, on the second diagram, we can see there is a platelet secretion. What are they secreting? Serotonin that we have talked about. At an expense where the blood vessels are also releasing the thromboxanes that is essential in the aggregation of the platelets. At the end, we can see that the platelets have actually aggregated or forming a clot. They've got, it's more like they've accumulated together to form this plaque so as to enhance the strength and integrity so as to avoid the bleeding or to stop the bleeding that is current. The third stage, it is actually coagulation, which is the blood clotting at the end. So now we're saying that this blood clotting or the coagulation is the complex process that also it's said to be the positive feedback mechanism, in that it happen due to the preceding stimulation that is going to occur. So in this case, the blood clotting, it is going to result from the formation of an insoluble thread-like mesh of the fibrin. Like we have seen, there will be aggregation of those platelets forming the thread-like mesh, which is of fibrin. And as we are going to talk about the hemostasis process, we are going to see how fibrin it is involved in the production of this mesh that we're talking about here. So in the final stage of this process, the prothrombin activator acts on the plasma protein prothrombin converting it to thrombin. So remember, we are talking about the process. So we are going to talk about the process by which this prothrombin, it is going to be converted into thrombin, so as to enhance this platelet formation that we have seen. So the thrombin that is going to be converted from the prothrombin, it acts on another protein called the fibrinogen, and this fibrinogen, it is the one that is going to convert itself into fibrin, and the fibrin, it is the essential substance that has the mechanism of forming that thread-like mesh that we talked about, which is going to cover the site of injury so as to stop the bleeding in an instance of the blood vessel damage. So I said that the prothrombin activator can be formed by two processes, which can either occur as an extrinsic process or the intrinsic process. And the extrinsic process is said that it occurs rapidly. That's why you find that the healing or the wound, actually, for example, if at all, let's talk about the bleeding, if there was a bleeding, you find that on top, extrinsically or the site, it is going to form this mesh. But when you remove that mesh manually, you are going again to induce the bleeding, because inside it has not yet fully formed that mesh. So it actually quickly on extrinsic part of it. So the damaged tissue releases a complex substance or chemical that is said to be thromboplastin. In other translation, it is said to be thrombokinase, which is a tissue factor to initiate the coagulation. Coagulation, we said this is an aggregation of the blood vessels to form the clot. And the intrinsic pathways now are going now to circulate together also to form the mesh that we have been talking about, which is now intrinsically. So after the time of the clot formation, because there is a blood that is within that process that is happening, there are also fluids that are accumulating there. So as this clot is being formed, the fluids are going to drain away from that clot so as to ensure its integrity. So this is the process that we have been talking about, the major components of hemostasis. So first thing, you are going to have the vascular injury. From vascular injury, secondly, let's follow the right arrows. From the vascular injury, what are you going to have is actually the tissue factor. In this case, the tissue factor we are talking about, it is actually the thromboplastin. And this thromboplastin, it is going to stimulate the prothrombin that is going to act on another enzyme to change its nature into thrombin. When it changes to thrombin, it is going to stimulate the fibrinogen to convert itself into the fibrin. And when the fibrin does occur, then the blood clot, it is going to result. So this is actually the process. From the blood clot, as the wound is getting to get healed, you find that there will be fibrinolysis. Fibrinolysis in this case is just the breaking down of the clot so as to ensure the regularity of the blood vessels and its integrity. And when you're talking about the left side here, these arrows on the left side are just showing that mechanism or the process of hemostasis, which is includes the vasoconstriction and the platelets activation in order to aggregate at the site of an injury. This is about the thrombocytes. And we are done on the thrombocytes. Now we are starting talking about the lymphatic system. Pay much attention on lymphatic system, because it's one of the systems which involves the circulation, the circulatory process, and it is very much essential in the body in that it plays the major role in the immune system. In what sense? Let's see. All body tissues are said that they bathe in the tissue fluid. And this tissue fluid that we are talking about in this case, it is the lymph fluid. So some tissue fluid retains to capillaries, when these body tissues are bathing within the tissue fluids, the tissue fluid is said that it contains the constituents of the blood and waste materials from cells. And these tissue fluid, they are going to sift through the capillaries and found themselves into the tissues. From the tissue, the fluid will have to get back to the bloodstream, but not all the bloodstream is going to drain the fluid from the tissues. Other fluids are going to move from the tissues instead of going to the bloodstream, and they are going to find themselves into the lymphatic system, and in the lymphatic vessels they are going to come the lymph. That's the lymphatic system we're talking about, the lymph. That's how it is formed in this case. So we're saying that the lymph passes through the vessels of increasing size and varying in number of lymph nodes that they contain, because this lymphatic system, their target, as they are transporting the lymph containing the microorganisms and other substances, they take that to the lymphatic tissues and organs. So some of these lymphatic tissues, it is the lymph node, and we're going to talk about the lymph node, what is it all about. So throughout our discussion on the lymphatic system, expect to talk about the lymph itself, the lymph vessels, the lymph nodes, the lymph organs, for instance, the spleen and the thymus. These are the largest two lymph organs that we're going to be talking about. So let's start with the lymph itself. What's the function of the lymphatic system at large? First thing, the function is the tissue drainage, just like we have mentioned. We said the fluid that is going to seep through from the blood capillaries into the tissues, as it is getting back to the bloodstream, the amount of fluid is not going to get back to the bloodstream, but rather it is going to find itself in the lymphatic system. And it is in this lymphatic system now where we're saying that about 3 to 4 liters of fluids are going to drain into the lymphatic vessels. Hence, this has a good impact in a sense that it ensures the cardiovascular function, in that it doesn't congest the bloodstream with a large accumulation of the fluid. Hence, it actually acts in the tissue drainage as one of the functions. The second function, it is absorption in the small intestines. The lymphatic system actually plays the major role in the absorption of the fats and the fat soluble substances within the intestines. So this is just one of the important. So we're saying that, for instance, the fat soluble vitamins are absorbed into the central lactules. These lactules, when you hear the term lactules, are just talking about the lymphatic vessels. Quite all right. The third function is that this lymphatic system actually plays the role in the immunity, just like it was mentioned earlier. So we're saying that the lymphatic organs are concerned in the production of the maturation and maturation of the lymphocytes, which are actually the white blood cells that are responsible for the provision of an immunity. And we're going to talk about how is it that it plays the role in the immunity. That's why when you're talking about lymphocytes, lymph, we're talking about, it is referring to the lymphatic system. Then cyte, it is just a cell. Hence, lymphocytes from lymphatic system. That's the major function that you need to take note of. And we're saying that these lymphocytes are actually being produced on the bones, hence making the bone marrow said to be the lymphatic tissue. If we are to move on, the lymph, it is one of the objectives that we have, as we have already mentioned, that we need to pay much attention to as we are looking at lymphatic systems. In this case, we're saying that the lymph, it is just the fluid, the clear watery fluid that is going to be found within the lymphatic system or lymphatic vessels. And its composition, it is similar to that of the plasma fluid that we know found in the blood tissue. So the lymph, it transports the plasma proteins, which actually seeps from the capillary beds in the tissues, just like we have mentioned earlier on. And also it also carries away larger particles like bacteria, cell debris from the damaged tissue, and are filtered out. And also it destroys by substances that are destroyed by the lymph nodes. So all what we are talking about in this case, having that the lymphatic system, it is involved in the immunity, hence there's a phagocytosis that takes place. The lymph, as the fluid which is found in the lymphatic system, it has the function of transporting those substances that have been destroyed during the process of phagocytosis. And these are what we are talking about as being the bacteria, the cell debris, and the tissue damages, and all those microorganisms that have been destroyed by the lymph nodes. So the lymph, it contains the lymphocytes, just like we have mentioned. and also which circulates within the different sites of the body, so as to patrol looking for foreign invaders that could be in form of antigens and microorganisms that are foreign to body. So that's the function of the lymph. And in the lacteals, which are the lymphatic vessels or the small intestines, the lymph acts as in the digestive system to absorb the fats and also the fat soluble vitamins, so as to circulate them throughout the body to nourish the cells and other tissues. What are the functions of the lymph? In this previous slide, it has been just a description, though we've got managed to come up with some of the functions. So in this case, the functions of the lymph, first is that it transports the plasma proteins, those that seeps from the capillary beds back to the bloodstream. Because you find that there's a way this lymphatic system joins with the bloodstream, and we said that there are the other fluids that are going to seep into the tissues that are going to fail to get back to the bloodstream, rather they are going to be absorbed by the lymphatic system at the end. As the circulation is taking place, it will be taken back to the bloodstream so as to maintain the blood volume. And also another function, it is actually carrying larger particles, or rather those particles that have been involved in the phagocytosis, just like it has been mentioned in the previous slide. And in this case, the lymph also, it plays the function in the immunity, in that it contains the lymphocytes that are actually patrolling throughout the body so as to ensure the destruction of the microorganisms and the phagocytosis or the foreign invaders that can be detrimental to the body. The lymph vessels. So we are done looking at the lymph. What about the lymph vessels? The lymph vessels, we've got the capillaries, the lymph capillaries that originates as blinded tubes in the interstitial spaces. So what remain in this case, they do not have the specific site where these are actually vessels, they come from, but they are blind-ended tubes. And they have the structures like just it is with the blood vessels or the blood capillaries. Just that with these lymphatic capillaries, they are more permeable to allow interstitial fluid and other substances to permit or to go into them. And we're saying that the tiny capillaries, they join up to form the larger lymph vessels. So just like it was with the blood vessels, we talked about, for example, from arterial, we are going to have arteries, large arteries like an aorta. We talked about the veins. The veins, they come from the venules. If we start with its simplicity, we have come from the capillary bed. Then we are going to move to the venules. Venules to veins. Veins, vena cava. Just like it is in the same mechanism with the lymphatic capillaries or lymphatic vessels, they actually comes from the small capillary lymph capillaries, and that are going to join up together to form larger lymph vessels that we're going to talk about. So all tissues of the body have the networks of lymphatic vessels except the central nervous system, the bones, and the most superficial layer of the skin. So with the bones, we talked about it being the part of the lymphatic tissue, in that it is responsible for the production of the lymphocytes, but we are saying that it doesn't have the network of lymphatic vessels. And the central nervous system, due to the fact that we've got the blood-brain barrier, which does not permit anything to cross over that meninges to cross to the brain and the superficial layer of the skin. The lymph, the larger lymph vessels that you need to understand, we've got first thing, we have the thoracic duct, and we also have right lymphatic duct. These are the first two, only two, so to speak. These are the two largest lymph vessels that you as a student, you need to know. Now, what are these vessels that we're talking about? First, let's start with the thoracic duct. The thoracic duct, in this case, it begins from the stomach hilli. This stomach hilli that we're talking about is actually found at the inferior part of the thoracic cavity, and in this case, we're saying that it is actually a dilated lymph channel that is situated in front of the bodies of the first two lumbar vertebrae. And we're going to see the visual aid that is going to demonstrate on this vessel comes from. And the further thing that you need to take note of, about this is about its length. The thoracic duct is about 40 centimeter long, and it opens into the left subclavian vein in the root of the neck. So we're going to see where the left subclavian vein actually it is found. And it drains the lymph from both legs, the pelvic and the abdominal cavity, the left half of the thoracic, the head, the neck, and the left arm. Friends, I'm encouraging you to take note of every point that is found on this slide. First thing, note that we've got two large lymph vessels, the thoracic duct, and the right lymphatic duct. And we're saying that the thoracic duct, it originates from the systema chyli, and we also talked about its length is about 40 centimeters, and we talked about where it opens is into the subclavian vein, and also the parts that it drains its lymph contents. This is the diagram that is showing us the lymphatic vessels that we're talking about. So we can see on the upper left arm, we can see the right lymphatic duct that we have been demonstrating. And also at the middle left sided, we have the thoracic duct, which is about the 40 centimeters long. And down there, we can see where it is showing the systema chyli. That's where it actually originates. So it drains into left subclavian vein. So we can see on the right hand side, we've got the left subclavian vein on the left side of the diagram. And also, we also have the thoracic duct that is showing right there. Let's talk about the right lymphatic duct in this case. The right lymphatic duct is a dilated lymph vessels, which is only about 1% long. Have you seen the difference? The thoracic duct, it was for about 40 centimeters, but in this case, the right lymphatic duct is about just a centimeter. And it lies in the root of the neck, and it opens in the right subclavian vein. The thoracic, it was in the left. In this case, the right, it is in the right subclavian vein. And it drains from the right half of the thoracic cavity, from the head, and also the neck, not forgetting the right arm. So take note of the sites where this right lymphatic duct drains its content from. So we have just repeated the very diagram. This diagram, it is showing the right lymphatic duct there upper, and we can see where it opens actually into the right subclavian veins, and we can see that actually it receives its content from the upper part of the body. So this is about the two largest lymphatic vessels. We continue on the lymphatic organs and tissues. The first organ or rather tissue that we're going to talk about and the lymphatic organs and tissues is the lymph node. The lymph nodes are said to be oval bean shaped organs which lies in groups. Actually, where they are found in groups along the length of the lymphatic vessels. So the lymph, they are going to drain their contents into these lymph nodes that are going to actually to filter the blood for the presence of foreign invaders that are not that should not have to be found within the blood vessels. Here we've got the demonstration of the lymphatic system, where we can see some of the regions where we have the lymph nodes. So this is about the lymphatic system. Look at the inguinal region, we've got the inguinal lymph nodes. And also in the axilla, we've got the axillary lymph nodes. Actually, there are a number of sites where you are going to find these lymph nodes. This is just a brief form so as to understand the lymph nodes that we're talking about. And we can see that actually they are found in numbers or in groups or in clusters, so to speak. What's the function of the lymph nodes? Having said that it's one of the organs, now what's this function? Actually, the first function is that it filters and phagocytosizes the presence of microorganisms that are detected in the body. Secondly, or rather, on the very filtering, we are saying that the lymph is filtered by the reticular and lymphoid tissues as it passes through the lymph nodes so as to detect the presence of microorganisms. And once found, they are destroyed by phagocytosis. And also another function is organic material that are being destroyed by the lymph nodes. Organic materials is destroyed in the lymph nodes by microphages and the antibodies. So within the lymph nodes, we've got the macrophages and the antibodies that are essential in playing the function of phagocytosis, which is the destruction of the microorganisms. And also, some inorganic substances or objects are going to be held, but you find that sometimes are not going to be destroyed. But what is it that is going to happen, being that the lymph node is a tissue and we're having the monocytes that are in the tissue that have been converted into macrophages? These macrophages are going to engulf those microorganisms that sometimes they may damage the cells, sometimes they can be damaged, but that's the function of these lymph nodes. In some cases where phagocytosis fails, just like we have said, or maybe it is incomplete in a sense that the lymph nodes have not managed to kill those microorganisms, you are going to find the enlargement of the nodes. And this is what is said to be lymphadenopathy. So when you hear the term lymphadenopathy, this is actually the enlargement or the swelling of the lymph nodes in an instance of an infection. And it is seen when injury has occurred or when the person is having the chronic infection. Another function of the lymph nodes is proliferation of the lymphocytes. The proliferation in this case, we're just talking about the increment in number, because we've seen that actually the lymphocytes are found in the lymphatic system. So this is a tissue that actually helps in the maturation or rather the production of these lymphocytes, so that actually they can play their role in the immunity. And it also activates the lymphocyte, which is B, T and B lymphocytes, so as to multiply within the lymph nodes and increase in number. And also, it produces the antibodies that are actually essential in activating the B lymphocytes, so as to play its function in the phagocytosis. So this is the function of the lymph nodes. We talk about the spleen. The spleen in this case is the largest organ of lymphatic system. And we're saying that the spleen, it is actually in, lies or found in the left hypochondriac region of the abdomen, abdominal cavity, between the fundus of the stomach and the diaphragm. That's the location where you are going to find the spleen. And it is in color, it is said to be purplish, and also it varies in size according to the age of an individual, but mostly the normal size of the spleen, it is about 12 centimeters long, 7 centimeters wide, and about 2.5 centimeters thick, and then it weighs about 200 grams. Take note of every point that has been said also on this slide. So before we talk about the functions of the spleen, let's see the location that we talked about. So in this diagram that I had shown earlier, we can see the spleen where it is located. So we say that it's just beneath the diaphragm, and it was also posterior to the abdominal cavity, or rather in the posterior to the stomach, just behind the stomach but within the abdominal cavity. So here, that's what the spleen we are talking about, that's the location of the spleen. We can continue now talking about the functions of the spleen. First thing, it plays the function in the phagocytosis. Phagocytosis, this is just the process by which microorganisms get to be engulfed and also being destroyed by the immune cells of the body. So the spleen, it helps in that matter. How does it do so? We're saying that just as it has been described, the odd abnormal erythrocytes are destroyed in the spleen, and also the breakdown products, the bilirubin, the iron, and or are passed to the liver via the splenic and portal veins. So okay, what you are talking about in this case, there's a destruction of the odd red blood cells, odd erythrocytes, odd thrombocytes, just like we have mentioned, if you can remember, when we were talking about the platelets, they are being destructed on the by the spleen. Not only does it do so, but it also plays the function in the phagocytosis. How so? We are saying that other cellular material, for instance, like leukocytes, platelets, microbes, are also phagocytosized in the spleen. There's actually the destruction of the presence of these substances that have been mentioned here. The other function of the spleen, it is actually plays the function in the storage of blood. The spleen, it contains about 350 mL of blood that can be released in the blood circulatory system when hemorrhage occurs. There are instances whereby the person has been bleeding for a long period of time, whereby there's a hemorrhage or reduced amount of the blood volume within the circulatory system. The spleen, it is going to release the amount of blood that is containing. So it plays the function in the storage of blood. Also, the spleen plays the function in the immune responses. Just like we have already said, the activation of T and B lymphocytes, which are actually differentiated and it becomes special to fight against the specific infection. So there's an activation of T lymphocytes and B lymphocytes so that they can actually manage to or to make them become immunocompetent to fight against the antigens and the infections. So lymphocytes proliferation during the serious infection can cause enlargement of the spleen. So what we are saying, when the spleen has been involved largely due to the presence of the chronic infection and there is a proliferation of the lymphocytes, proliferation of the lymphocytes is just an increase in the number of lymphocytes due to the presence of an infection, it is going to result in what we call splenomegaly. So splenomegaly in this case is just an enlargement of the spleen due to the fact of an infection or involvement in the production of red blood cells and also involvement in the proliferation of the lymphocytes. Another function, it is actually erythropoiesis. Not only does it store blood, but also it is a function, it plays the function in the production of red blood cells, more especially in the fetal blood cell production. So in the production of the red blood cells for the fetal age humans or in the fetus and the infants, the spleen can play the role in the production of blood. The other organ or the lymphatic system, it is a thymus gland. The thymus gland in this case, it is said to lie in the upper part of the mediastinum behind the sternum and it extends upwards into the root of the neck and it weighs about 10 to 15 grams. And as a person is growing, is increasing in age, also its weight is going to increase, more especially at the puberty age. But when the person is crossing over the puberty age, it is going to atrophy, or rather to shrink like, and it is going to reduce in its weight, getting back to the normal weight it was like during at birth, which is the 10 to 15 grams that we have talked about. So what is it that we're talking about in this case? Let's see the diagram, which is showing us the thymus that we have said. So here we can see on the diagram the thymus where it is located, actually in the thoracic cavity and posterior to the sternum, but mediastinum. So this is the location of the thymus in this case. We move on. What's the function of the thymus gland in this case? The function, it is actually the origination of the lymphocytes. We see the thymus is actually a gland which secretes the protein, the hormone called the thymocyte, which actually increases the production of the lymphocytes in an instance of the infection. And also it helps in the maturation and activation of these lymphatic cells that are essential. And we are saying that the T lymphocytes, the thymic process produces mature T lymphocytes that can distinguish cell tissue from foreign tissues and also provides each T lymphocyte with ability to react to only one specific antigen from the medium it you encounter. So what we're talking about is the cell differentiation in this case. The thymus, it helps the T lymphocytes to actually differentiate and be able to be immunocompetent and fight against the specific the antigens that it may encounter. And the T lymphocytes, when they leave the thymus gland, they are going to enter into the blood. And from the bloodstream, they are going to start circulating. As the T lymphocytes production, it is going to be stimulated by the thymocyte that we've talked about. So we're saying that although most are prolific in youths, continues probably throughout life from a resident population of thymic stem cells. So we're talking about the increment in the T lymphocytes production which is there in children mostly due to the fact of immunosuppressed, and there will be the need of the lymphocytes that are going to be needed in this case. And as the person is advancing, there will be a reduction in the production of this thymocyte, which actually stimulates the production of the thymocyte or the production of T lymphocytes. Friends, thank you very much for your time. This brings us to the end of our today's discussion. I guess it's been awesome and interesting to know more about the thrombocytes, to know more about the lymphatic system. Thank you very much for your time and for your attention. Stay safe.